we just didn't really give a about anything else going on around us. There was no holds barred.
They looked like outlaws. The music was like nothing I had ever heard.
I Guns N' Roses hanno salvato il rock and roll con un sound unico, frutto di una vita votata all'eccesso.
It was a 24-hour day party. Tupperware is full of cocaine.
I hear when I look over and Duff would be laid out on the stage, passed out.
Capeggiati dall'ipnotico Axl Rose, i Guns N' Roses potevano ispirare devozione religiosa, risse, o entrambe le cose.
I went out to the stage and, you know, they're shredding the place.
The whole place just collectively destroyed everything.
It was insane.
Where do we go? Fin da subito il pericolo più grande per i Guns erano i Guns stessi.
I did everything I possibly could to try and kill myself.
I got a phone call saying Slash is dead. I mean, dead, blue dead. He had no pulse.
Consacrati all'abuso continuo di droghe e alcol, ci vollero solo pochi anni prima che i Guns si rivoltassero l'uno contro l'altro.
That's the sound of the band breaking up right there.
A band is a marriage, and they were bound for divorce court.
I Guns N' Roses raccontati da Behind the Music.
Come on, buddy.
That was a hot show.
Thank you, fellas. Step on back.
In New York, welcome to the jungle. Ladies and gentlemen, good.
Nell'agosto del 2002, sette anni dopo lo scioglimento della band più pericolosa del mondo, Axl Rose, che nel frattempo ha condotto una vita da recluso, si presenta agli MTV Music Awards con i Guns N' Roses. Il nome della band è noto, ma le facce no.
A lot of people think it's almost sacrilege, you know, to do it that way, but he doesn't give a hot.
Sick of this life. I Guns, reclutati da Axl, non hanno niente in comune con i delinquenti del rock che negli anni Ottanta avevano suscitato le ire dei genitori e mandato in estasi i fan, con quel loro sound di vite vissute all'insegna della decadenza e del rischio.
Me and Duff were drinking at least a half gallon of vodka or Jack Daniels a day, just trying to sort of keep ourselves, you know, like on an even keel.
They lived it, and that's why, you know, they were one notch above everybody else. They were the real deal.
Ma alla fine i Guns si sono lasciati soffocare dai loro eccessi. Neanche 10 anni dopo aver scioccato il mondo con il loro album d'esordio Appetite for Destruction, droga, alcol e manie di protagonismo distruggono il gruppo.
Everything was falling apart. Everything was wrong that was going on there. I mean, it was trouble after trouble after trouble, you know, it didn't stop.
You didn't know from one minute if it was going to end because of a drug overdose, because of a riot, because of it just imploding. But at the same time, you didn't know if that same day you were going to see the greatest musical performance of all time.
I Guns N' Roses hanno origine tra le sudice strade della Hollywood del 1982. Dove due sbandati di nome Steven Heather e Saul Hudson, alias Slash, inseguono i loro sogni rocchettari.
Steven started playing drums and I started playing guitar and we started a band. And that's where Guns starts for me.
Verso la fine dell'84 i due aspiranti musicisti vedono a Los Angeles una band di nome Hollywood Rose, capitanata da Jeffrey Isabel e Bill Bailey, due ragazzi dell'Indiana che hanno cambiato i propri nomi in Izzy Stradlin e W. Axl Rose. Slash e Steven rimangono a dir poco stregati dall'esibizione di Axl.
After the show, I introduced Axl to Slash, and who knew that that was like history in the making, but that was the first time Slash met Axl.
I said to Slash, if we get that singer, that guitar player, we'll have a kick-ass band.
All'alba del marzo 85, Steven e Slash si sono già uniti ad Axl e Izzy. Quello stesso mese il bassista Michael Duff McKagan completa la formazione che prende il nome di Guns N' Roses.
We went through so many different people and this ended up being the people that we most believed in. We're like a family, we believe in each other.
We were a gang, that's how we thought of ourselves. We play rock and roll music to kick your ass.
I Guns sono finalmente pronti a partire. E le loro brucianti performance dal vivo offrono subito una pericolosa alternativa a gruppi metal laccati e truccati come Cinderella e Poison.
All these other bands, you know, they had all these spandex and makeup and crap. And we didn't. We just went out there and played rock and roll.
They looked like outlaws, that was number one. And the music was, to me, like nothing I had ever heard.
We just didn't really give a shit about anything else going on around us. We just had this edge, this sort of unpredictable, scary thing about what it was that we did, and that there was no holds barred.
Fin dagli inizi, la fame di successo dei Guns è paragonabile solo al loro appetito per gli eccessi.
Quite often it was a 24-hour day party. Tupperware's full of cocaine. Literally Tupperware's. Everybody was completely strung out and using ecstasy.
Nobody drank as much as Slash, and nobody passed out as much as Slash.
We were just following in the footsteps of all the guys that we grew up, you know, that were our heroes growing up. And then we just took it that one step further.
Praticamente senza casa e vagabondando da una bettola all'altra, i Guns hanno in mente solo due obiettivi: godersi la vita e suonare musica rock.
These guys were living off of biscuits, gravy from Denny's, you know, from friends.
There's usually at least a few bodies on the floor that you had to step over when you walked in. There was always a song written on a pizza box and empty liquor bottles everywhere.
We were always scrounging to find a place to practice or find a place to crash. And back in those days, the best people to know were strippers because they are the ones that were empathetic, you know, to your needs.
Sul palco regalano una musica martellante, corredata dai minacciosi testi composti da Axl Rose, che, avendo alle spalle un'infanzia difficile, scrive canzoni per scacciare i suoi demoni.
As volatile as he is, all the things that you might find complicated or difficult about Axl is what fuels him to be such an amazing performer and such an amazing songwriter.
You know, it's like I have to like balance out, you know, when can I destroy everything around me to when I have to be nice to everybody.
L'instabilità di Axl è sia una benedizione che una maledizione. Nell'86 i Guns sono già la band più popolare di Los Angeles. Ma le case discografiche li evitano.
Nobody wanted to sign us. I mean, even though the people that wanted to sign us, they didn't want to deal with us. Nobody wanted to produce us. Nobody wanted to manage us. And, you know, the club owners were scared of us.
I Guns N' Roses sono una polveriera che può esplodere da un momento all'altro. Ma nella primavera dell'86 Tom Zutaut, un responsabile della Geffen, vede la band in un locale e decide che pur di averli vale la pena sopportare qualche sofferenza.
I basically went to David Geffen and I said, I just saw the biggest rock and roll band in the world. They're going to sell more records than any band except for maybe Led Zeppelin and the Rolling Stones.
I Guns N' Roses firmano un contratto con la Geffen, ma sono in pochi a credere che riscriveranno la storia del rock o anche solo che sopravviveranno a loro stessi. Tra poco, il gusto del successo, vita da Guns.
There were photo session when Slash literally was propped up, so he wouldn't fall down for the photo session.
Panorama delle band cotonate di Hollywood ottenendo un contratto con la Geffen. La casa discografica teme però che il suo investimento possa andare in fumo da un momento all'altro.
Well, I was worried about them surviving because you can't tell junkies or drug addicts to stop taking drugs. They probably laughed when I said, guys, I mean, be careful, you know, you're going to be the biggest rock and roll band in the world. You don't need to destroy it with this crap.
You always kind of thought that, you know, there would be like the explosion and it would all be over, or one of them would die or something would happen.
Oh, yeah, we're the bad boys.
Nell'agosto dell'86 la Geffen porta i Guns in studio. Ma la band non permetterà mai che un rigido programma di registrazioni condizioni le sue sregolatezze.
On any given night, terrorizing Hollywood. Every morning we'd have to get up and somehow manage to be at the studio by 12.
They came in many, many times well hung over.
Malgrado gli eccessi, i Guns stanno per scrivere una pagina nella storia della musica. Una delle canzoni nate durante quelle sessioni è una ballata incredibilmente dolce, Sweet Child O' Mine. Sembrerà strano, ma Slash inventa il famoso riff iniziale per gioco.
We were rehearsing, the young guitar center, and then he started playing like a circus kind of thing. You know? And I was like, dude, play that again.
What started out as a joke guitar riff for me turned into a huge anthem for Axl as far as that relationship that he was in at the time. So it was a very heartfelt moment in his life.
Axl scrive il testo insolitamente dolce come una lettera dedicata a Erin Heverly, con cui ha una tumultuosa relazione per 5 anni.
When it was good, it was good, and when it was bad, it was horrible. There was a lot of turmoil between those two. And that's all I want to say.
Erin was a very nice girl. She was cute as could be. She was just the opposite as Axl. But it also shows a side of Axl, Sweet Child of Mine, that you wouldn't necessarily when you hear all these nasty things about him.
Ma Sweet Child of Mine è solo uno sprazzo di tenerezza. In un album dominato da inni incendiari come Welcome to the Jungle. Appetite for Destruction esce nell'agosto dell'87 e bombarda i fan con la violenza musicale di 5 musicisti costantemente in bilico sul filo del rasoio.
They were, you know, they were living, you know, hand to mouth, and they were just all about the rock and the girls and the drinks, and that's what they sang about. That's what they did. And they lived it. It's a pretty much a storybook of everything that Axl and the band was going through from, say, the beginning of the 80s all the way up until the record was finished.
Nell'agosto dell'87 Guns N' Roses intraprendono un tour mondiale per promuovere il disco, portando in giro per il mondo il loro circo degli eccessi.
A bunch of crazy kids that had just been given the key to every city in the world, you know, basically.
There were photo sessions when Slash literally was propped up, you know, the head up and somebody behind him, you know, to hold him up so he wouldn't fall down for the photo session.
Slash is a very dedicated player. He would go and throw up behind the amps, come back out, keep playing. He smoked on stage, and his cigarette would drop down in between his pants and his stomach. And I'm sitting there watching him going, you know, dude, you're burning up. And he's just doing this solo in pain.
Gli atteggiamenti e i testi scandalosi del gruppo mandano su tutte le furie ai genitori e Invisibilio ai fan. E nel luglio dell'88 Appetite for Destruction sale al primo posto delle classifiche.
It was the right band at the right time with the right message, and it just happened to hit the youth of America in a certain way that everybody related to it, which is great.
Ma proprio quando la band vola verso successi platinati, una tragedia li riporta con i piedi a terra. Il 20 agosto 1988, durante il concerto dei Guns al Monsters of Rock Donington in Inghilterra, due fan muoiono schiacciati dal pubblico scatenato.
And so we finished the gig, our manager didn't tell us about it, so we met up at a pub later on, and I found him in the bar sort of crying, and he told me about that. And it's like, that was when the reality kicked in, that you can get to this all-time high, something that you can't compare to anything, and then have it go to an all-time low.
It really screws with your head. He drove to the show with his friends, they were having a good time, they got out of their car, they walked into the gig, and he didn't walk out.
La morte dei due fan alimenta come vento sul fuoco le critiche rivolte alla band e rafforza il presentimento che i Guns siano destinati a una fine prematura. Tra poco, i Guns contro Steven Adler.
I did everything I possibly could to try and kill myself.
Entro la fine dell'88 i Guns N' Roses surclassano con il loro stile sporco e rude il rock cotonato delle band di quegli anni. Appena un anno dopo l'uscita del loro album di esordio sono già una delle band più famose del mondo.
They were the baddest thing on the block at the time.
They had a certain genuineness to them that I think people really attached themselves to. They were what they were, and what you saw is what you got.
I had no expectations for it to be such a global event.
One, two, one, two, three, four.
Nel novembre dell'88 i Guns pubblicano l'EP GNRLies, che include quattro nuove canzoni realizzate in una sola e ispirata giornata di registrazioni. Trascinato dalla ballata da Hit Parade, Patience, l'album vende 2 milioni di copie.
Basically, it was a live session. I recorded everybody in the same room and in a circle, and they all played together, and it was pretty magical.
We did the Lives record, and it was like a real easy, quick thing to do, which was really successful, which was sort of a shock. One day's work, and sells like all these copies.
Nonostante il successo, continue polemiche minacciano di compromettere il futuro dei Guns. Una delle tracce contenute in GNRLies, One in a Million, presenta un testo controverso, carico di riferimenti razziali, che attira molte critiche.
The word was used on the record, but that didn't necessarily mean all black people. It just, you know, it meant basically lowlifes, so people that were like stealing, you know, to supply their drug habits.
It hit home with me on a bad level because I'm half black for one, so you start saying the word around me and it's very unsettling.
To Tuttavia, il mare di proteste non fa che aumentare le vendite dell'album. Nel febbraio dell'87, mentre GNRLs raggiunge Appetite for Destruction ai primi posti delle classifiche, la band decide di tirare un po' il fiato. Ma il periodo di pausa si trasforma ben presto in giorni e notti di perdizione.
That's where we really went downhill. That's where I got lost, Izzy got lost, Steven got lost, Duff even got lost, and Axel disappeared somewhere.
Slash didn't know how to entertain himself unless he was on stage or going to a gig or doing something. You know, so what did he do? Wake up, drink, and drink more.
I love Slash to death, but his drug abuse was out of control. Steven's drug abuse was out of control. You know, Duff's drinking, and Axel's, you know, wild-eyed vision of reality was out of control.
Nell'ottobre dell'89 i Guns ricevono un'offerta allettante: aprire 4 concerti dei Rolling Stones a Los Angeles. È l'occasione ideale per rimettersi in pista, ma in apertura della prima serata Axl fa una dichiarazione sconvolgente.
He implied if certain members don't stop dancing with Mr. Brownstone, meaning Slash and drugs, you know, the band was over.
They all were messing around with heroin, but somebody had a real big problem, and if they didn't stop doing it, that was the end of Guns N' Roses.
I know it was directed at me because I was all strung out at the time. That was one of the things that probably made me hate Axl more than anything. Something I probably never, ever forgave him for without really even thinking about it.
Le polemiche sembrano galvanizzare la band. Nella primavera del 90 i Guns tornano in studio per lavorare al loro progetto più complesso. Un doppio album di materiale del tutto nuovo.
We all managed to sort of straighten ourselves out, with the exception of Steven. Steven was so locked up that he just couldn't get it together.
He was so messed up with junk that he couldn't pull off the tracks.
La band ha grandi ambizioni per il nuovo album, ma Adler, debilitato dalla sua tossicodipendenza, ormai è inservibile in studio, tanto che la band deve interrompere le registrazioni.
He couldn't play. He would lie to us. And we go over to his place and find behind the toilet and find stuff underneath the sink.
He couldn't leave his drugs, but there's other things beside the band that he was involved in with his drugs that been very dangerous and scary, and I want nothing to do with him.
Nel luglio del 90, frustrata dalla mancanza di progressi, la band licenzia Steven Adler, facendolo sprofondare sempre più nella depressione e nell'abuso di droghe, tanto che il batterista viene colpito da un ictus indotto dalla cocaina.
I did everything I possibly could to try and kill myself. I had nothing left for it. I mean, everybody that I knew, I thought were my friends, took everything they could from me and disappeared. I would drink a whole bottle of vodka just down it right before the sun was coming up so I could pass out.
Mentre Steven rotola in un abisso fatale, la band recluta il batterista Matt Sorum, ex Cult, e nel settembre del 90 comincia a dare forma alle canzoni che comporranno il doppio album Use Your Illusion.
I just want to bury Appetite. I don't want to live my life through that one album. I have to bury it. So rather than just throwing a bunch of songs together that we think are fun, we're going over it, you know, with a fine-tooth comb.
His creative idea of moving forward was, we can't remake Appetite. The next record has to be in another direction.
Ma i 5 delinquenti che tra un eccesso e l'altro hanno realizzato Appetite for Destruction sono ormai distanti. E fin da subito il nuovo progetto viene realizzato al telefono.
Slash and I do a lot of our communication by phone. You know, what do you think about the end note and this? Okay, we'll change that to this. Hold this note a little bit longer, da-da.
It was impossible to get us into one room, all of us, at one time.
It's very dark.
And there was a lot of just toxic sort of a feeling in the room. And the sightings of Axl Rose were few and far between.
User Illusions was all over the place. It was sort of like the Guns N' Roses version of the White Album, so to speak. Maybe not quite as good. It was like all this material coming from all different directions.
Nonostante tutti i problemi, il doppio album dei Guns è destinato a un successo fenomenale. E pochi immaginano che sarà anche l'ultimo sussulto artistico della band. Tra poco, i Guns perdono il controllo.
The whole place collectively destroyed everything. It was one of the scariest things I've ever seen.
All'inizio del 1991 il doppio album dei Guns N' Roses è addirittura d'arrivo e il gruppo sta progettando un tour mondiale. Ma quando iniziano il concerto i fan si accorgono che la band è cambiata radicalmente.
We had a horn section and pianos and all this other kind of crap, which we didn't necessarily want as a band, but it's something that Axl still wanted.
I remember feeling a bit like I didn't really sign up for this. I was kind of hoping to join a badass rock and roll band, you know. What's with the piano? When I look into your eyes,
I can see the numbers drain. It just got bloated. It's plain and simple.
Axl Rose, da sempre la figura dominante della band, è più che mai determinato a prendere il controllo del gruppo. Poco dopo l'inizio del tour, dà a Slash, Easy e Duff un ultimatum. Cedetemi i diritti del nome Guns N' Roses o il gruppo si ferma qui.
In his mind, the name belonged to him. And if something disintegrated, you know, he wanted to ensure Guns N' Roses' ultimate survival, even if this version of the band broke up.
If we didn't sign it, the band was going to break up right then and there. So we just did what we've always done and just kept the thing going.
All'interno del gruppo la tensione continua a salire e comincia a essere visibile anche sul palco. Nel luglio del 91 un concerto a St. Louis degenera nel caos dopo che Axl si tuffa tra il pubblico per strappare una videocamera a un fan.
I jumped off stage and yeah, things went haywire after that. And maybe I could have handled it better or whatever, but no one was really handling anything at that point. So I took it into my own hands with what I could do.
In pochi minuti migliaia di fan finiscono nel caos più completo.
The whole place just collectively destroyed everything. It was one of the scariest things I've ever seen. We were in the dressing room and I remember opening the door, it'd be like people on stretchers and they were all bloody and it was like gnarly.
I tell the driver just to get the quickest way out to the state line and get us out, and we drove, you know, here's the biggest band in the world laying down in the back of the van to escape arrest to get and drive to Chicago. It was insane.
Il tour va avanti e i fan non sanno mai cosa aspettarsi dai Guns. A volte Axl lascia il palco a metà concerto, altre non si presenta affatto. Ma in altre occasioni offre performance straordinarie che mandano in visibilio i fan.
He had that way of talking to the audience and speaking his mind that they could relate to, but he also had this swagger, like a lizard, you know, and the girls loved that.
I cannot recall one show I've seen that he didn't give me goosebumps in.
He was like the greatest rock and roll frontman ever.
I I concerti dei Guns sono diventati eventi spettacolari, ma neanche questo può prepararli all'isteria di massa che contraddistinguerà l'uscita del loro attesissimo doppio album.
There has been nothing like the anticipation of Use Your Illusions ever. They sound scanned 1,600,000 records the first week and was just this juggernaut that had not been seen since the Beatles, really.
Uscito nel settembre del 91, Use Your Illusion è un capolavoro imperfetto e spazia dalle grandi ballate ai pezzi rock più duri.
It just had a lot of everything, and it was the good, the bad, and the ugly of Guns N' Roses.
This was when we were going to pull all the stops. Everything we could think of to do that we wanted to do, we were going to do.
I Guns N' Roses sono sempre più famosi e sempre più divisi. Nella lavorazione dei video per le nuove canzoni, Axl delinea filmati elaborati e costosi, riservando pochissimo spazio al resto del gruppo.
Everything had to be bigger and better and more grander and more majestic and more money, and he had to splash it, and that he did.
For me, the biggest change in Guns N' Roses, I think, was the video when Axl decided that they needed an aircraft carrier and he's gonna jump over an aircraft carrier and swim with dolphins. Okay, that was the part that I said, you know what, that's not so street.
And that's where we just sort of completely separated. This group of guys is here, and this other guy is on this page.
Nel novembre del 91, proprio quando il gruppo si prepara un altro tour, Izzy Stradlin, stufo del pugno di ferro di Axl, molla su due piedi la band.
Izzy felt dictated to and quit.
Yeah.
Everybody wished they could go with him, but then you have your balancing, you know, your livelihood with, do I put up with this crap?
Poche settimane prima che i Guns comincino un tour nel dicembre del 91, il chitarrista Gilby Clark sostituisce Izzy, sapendo però che non sarebbe durata a lungo.
It's just, you know, here, learn the songs, play the songs, here's your paycheck. I knew from day one that it could end tomorrow. You know.
I Guns si rimettono in viaggio, ma fin da subito la band ha pochi contatti con Axl al di fuori del palco e nessuna idea di quando voglia presentarsi ai concerti.
It was hard, you know, so we had a lot of canceled gigs, we had a lot of gigs where we almost didn't play, we had a lot of like walking off the stage in the middle of the set and having, it was all very trying, you know.
I would be like, come on, you guys, I mean, we got to deal with this. Let's be a band. And every time I'd go out to deal with Axl, I'd turn around and they'd all gone the other way. Like, dudes, you said you were backing me up.
We would go down to the show and, you know, you have a cocktail at the show, you have another cocktail. And by the time you'd show up, we were hammered, you know, from sitting and drinking so much.
Ben presto l'abuso di alcol e droghe comincia a compromettere la sopravvivenza dei Guns.
I got a phone call at 5:30, 6 a.m. at my room from the front desk saying, Mr. Reese, one of your band members is passed out in front of the elevator on the sixth or fifth floor. So I throw on some pants, jump, run out my room, and Slash is dead. I mean, dead, blue dead. He had no pulse. Paramedics show up, bam, the adrenaline right into his heart.
Slash fugge alla morte per un pelo, ma Duff si sta lentamente uccidendo con l'alcol.
Duff was in terrible shape, he could barely speak.
I'd be on stage and I'd hear, when I look over and Duff would be laid out, his bass guitar on the stage and him passed out.
L'estate del 92, nonostante i fuochi d'artificio dietro le quinte, i Guns N' Roses si uniscono ai Metallica per un tour negli stadi. Ma l'8 agosto, durante un concerto a Montreal, il cantante dei Metallica, James Hetfield, si ustiona gravemente a causa di un gioco pirotecnico, lasciando ai Guns il compito di domare una folla esplosiva.
Axel could have probably saved the day, but his voice was messed up.
He just couldn't hear himself and chose to leave.
I went out to the stage and, you know, they're shredding the place. They're, you know, I saw bonfires, and this is an enclosed stadium. And they just looted everything. There were cop cars overturned. And, I mean, I've never seen anything like that. You know, that was my first riot.
That was a really sort of embarrassing moment for everybody, because it was like, you know, we have no control over this, you know?
I Guns tengono duro fino a luglio del 93, quando suonano per l'ultima volta insieme a Buenos Aires, davanti a un pubblico di 70.000 persone. Sarà l'ultimo concerto della formazione originale. Tra poco, i Guns si sciolgono.
Nobody wanted to come home, because I think everybody in the back of their mind thought that it was going to be over.
Il 17 luglio 1993 i Guns N' Roses terminano un tour durato 2 anni e mezzo, il più lungo nella storia del rock. Ma quando la band torna a Los Angeles, il suo futuro è più incerto che mai.
Even though the family was dysfunctional, they were still a family on the road.
Nobody wanted to come home, you know, nobody really wanted to end, because I think everybody in the back of their mind thought that it was going to be over.
Nel novembre del 93 i Guns pubblicano un album di cover, The Spaghetti Incident. Ma appena cominciano a lavorare a un nuovo disco, l'atteggiamento prevaricatore di Axl soffoca il resto della band.
It's not brain surgery. I mean, I've said it a million times. Dude, what are you doing over there? Who are you, Zubin Mehta, doing a 72-piece, you know, orchestral masterpiece?
Nel dicembre del 94 i Guns riescono a raffazzonare una cover di Sympathy for the Devil dei Rolling Stones per la colonna sonora di un film. Sarà l'addio musicale di Matt, Slash, Duff e Axl.
Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name.
That's the sound of the band breaking up right there.
Slash and Duff and them had much less patience for eating the amount of they had to eat to keep everything going.
A band is a marriage, and they were bound for divorce court.
Fine, nell'ottobre del 96, Slash esce dal gruppo e Matt Sorum e Duff McKagan lo seguono poco dopo. Successivamente Axl sparisce dalle scene per 5 anni, nei quali cerca di reinventare Guns N' Roses con una formazione inedita.
This has taken a long time.
Yeah, but it's also how do you rebuild something that got so big and replace virtually every person on the crew, every single thing.
Axl porta i suoi nuovi Guns in tour nel 2002, ma molte date fissate in Nord America vengono cancellate e il tour viene annullato dopo soli 15 concerti. Nel frattempo il suo nuovo album è in lavorazione da quasi 10 anni.
I think the guy has really fought hard to make Guns N' Roses relevant to whatever was going on, but he's waited so long, whatever was going on has changed a few times. I think he just, in his head, wants to achieve a sort of mythic perfection that may be impossible.
L'album di Axl, Chinese Democracy, viene finalmente dato in uscita per il novembre del 2004. Intanto Slash, Duff e Matt Sorum formano la super band Velvet Revolver, insieme a Scott Weiland, ex frontman degli Stone Temple Pilots.
Cut the rope, felt in my knees, born in
Nel giugno del 2004 debuttano con l'album Contraband, definito dalla critica un'esplosione graffiante di vero rock.
I'm out on the road, I'm touring, I'm on stage. Got some of the greatest musicians around me, and that's the most important thing.
I've been in enough bands and done enough sessions and played enough gigs. After all these years now, I do understand what it is. And to finally have that come around a second time is a real blessing.
I Guns hanno preso strade diverse, ma i fan continuano a sperare di rivederli insieme. Nell'aprile del 2004, un Greatest Hits dei Guns N' Roses è schizzato subito al terzo posto delle classifiche, ma una riunione definitiva sembra molto improbabile.
No matter how much money they stick in our face, there's no reason for us to get together to do anything unless we have some sort of mutual understanding or respect. And we're way, way far from that, so I don't see it anytime in the foreseeable future.
Comunque vadano le cose, l'eredità della band continuerà a vivere. Per 6 anni indimenticabili, i Guns hanno imperversato nel mondo della musica, rimodellando il rock a loro immagine e somiglianza.
That was a great experience, a great time. Will it ever be the same again? No, ever, never. That kind of will never happen again.